sound too out there, but I literally stayed out of jail all week because I knew we were going to do this on Sunday. And I was like, I got to be ready. I got to be ready. I can't, nobody's going to throw my bail. I gotta stay clean, but don't worry. They got nothing on me. Oh, good. So we are now recording. Fantastic. And let's try a little screen sharing exercise here. I'm going to put this up. Can you guys see my fabulous, amazing splash screen where we're setting alcoholic beverages on fire? Okay, very good. So feel free to grab one of your own. It's afternoon. That means it's okay. But yes, so what I have for you, so just to be clear, so what I have for you here is not going to be a prescription for life, the universe, and everything. This is not a formula to follow from first to last. It's not a complete recipe. What I have are 10 things that I have noticed in the course of working with writers. I do a lot of developmental editing. I'm a, part-time book doula. So these are just 10 things that I have noticed can be really helpful at a variety of stages in your story, almost regardless of genre. It is a bit biased toward fiction as opposed to memoir, but I think even memoir, we can use a lot of these ideas. And what I would like is for at least one of these hot tips that I'm going to give you to apply like the elbow of inspiration to the soda machine of your mind so that the coke of genius drops down and you can get it unstuck and you can have it and use it and be really excited about it in your writing. Like, wow, that's going to be so cool. I can't wait to go write that. So I'm not, so to be scintillatingly clear, you do not need to use any of these ideas in your work. It could be at least that not even one is suitable for what you're doing. But if at least one works for you, then I win. Okay, that's where the bar is. All right. So if I give you one thing that you're stoked about, then I will consider it a job well done. Let's get rolling. Oh, and y'all, please absolutely feel free to use the chat box as we go along. Those of you who have heard me in person know I really like the interactive aspect of live presentations. It's one of the things I really miss about our new Zoom lifestyle. So yes, please feel free to ask questions as we go. I will also be asking four questions periodically as we do this. So don't feel like you got to hold them to the end. One of the cool things about this whole chat box feature is you can ask questions without interrupting anything. It's not even rude. Just like we don't have to wear pants anymore, right? It's just one wonderful part of the new world order. So please take advantage of that. I love to hear your questions and ideas and comments, and we'll be addressing those as we go along. So buckle in. Here we go. So yes, 10 big ideas that do relate to the intersection of plot and character, right? Number one is actually, I'll call it dial up the contrast. But what I mean by that, we've heard a lot that conflict is the core of a story, and you guys probably heard this like, oh, conflict, we gotta have conflict, we gotta have conflict on every page, right? But I think there is a bigger idea underneath that, and that is contrast. Which is sort of like fundamentally interesting to the human brain. It is a thing that our ancestors depended on for survival. Picture very early hunter-gatherers who needed to see the contrast between the delicious, red ripe berries and the dark foliage in order to have food. They needed to see the contrast between the forest floor and the open hole so that they didn't fall into it, right? So contrast is kind of like, contrast is like a red hat on a beige background. It is cold ice cream on top of hot apple pie. And almost anything you're doing in your story, you can turn up the volume on by dialing up the contrast. Here's a couple of examples of that. You could dial up the contrast between your character and another character. So think about like the two characters in a buddy cop movie. You've got the grizzled, jaded veteran who's seen it all and done it all, and he's tired and cynical and 2 weeks away from retirement. And then he's paired with the young, hotshot maverick who's just graduated from the squad, and he's out to bring some scum to justice, and he's really fired up and energized. And that contrast really helps the story, right? It helps us create interesting scenarios even when the bad guy is nowhere on the screen, right? We can argue about what donut shop to go eat at, or whether it's okay to go put a banana in the bad guy's tailpipe, or, you know, or exhaust pipe or whatever. So dialing up the contrast between characters can be a fantastic way to add interest to your story, even when they're not actually fighting about something, even if it's just, it is almost like, think about some of the Looney Tunes characters look so interesting together because they're so different. One is big and one is tiny. One is big and strong and the other one is this little teeny weeny. Yeah. So we can dial up the contrast between characters. We can also dial up the contrast between a character and their environment. I put up the Legally Blonde slide here because I think that's a fantastic example. You can also think about, okay, so my mom, she has a knitting group that she goes to, and I like to call it, you know, she goes to her bitty committee every couple of weeks. And one day she said, oh, there was the most interesting person that joined our club. His name is Steve and he's a biker. And I'm just picturing this big dude, like this big tattooed guy with the patches on his jacket and the Hell's Angels, you know, motorcycle shirt, whatever, walking into a room of little old ladies with their crochet, which I know is not knitting. Don't crucify me in the comments. I do know that those are different things. But that person does not look like he belongs in that situation. And so we are automatically really interested to see, what's he doing there? Did he mean to walk in there? Does he have good intentions? Does he actually want to know about knit one, purl two? Like, what's going on? So especially in the very beginning of your story, having a character who doesn't look like they belong where they are can be a natural way to grab the audience's interest and look longer to try to resolve this strange mystery, right? Very often that's done as a fish out of water story where the character is in a new environment that makes them very, very uncomfortable. You can think about Miss Congeniality. Right? And here's this lady who's she's a cop and she's used to being a secret agent or something. And now suddenly she's has to pretend to be in a beauty pageant. She's really uncomfortable, right? So you can do a fish out of water story where the character is very uncomfortable in their new environment. Or like Legally Blonde, you could do a situation where the environment is uncomfortable with the character. You know, Elle Woods here, she is delighted to be, you know, she's fine. It's everybody else who's got a problem. So either way you run, there's going to be a natural interest happening there. And finally, you could also sometimes it's useful to dial up the contrast between your character and their other self. The example I have on my slide is the nutty professor, right? In which case it's the character and his ideal self, the person that he wishes he were, the person he wants to be. This is like a Charlie Brown example. Charlie Brown so badly wants to be the kid who can kick the football and fly the kite and win the ball game and talk to the little redheaded girl. And that contrast between the small and helpless person that he is and the capable and confident kid he wants to be animates so many of the Peanut stories, right? So you could dial up the contrast between your character and the person that they wish they were. You could dial up the contrast between your character and the person that they think they are. And then, and I'm going to ask you here to think about, depending on your generation, either Johnny Bravo or Pepe Le Pew, right? Think about the difference between who Pepe Le Pew thinks he is, the debonair lover, you know, and who he is perceived to be by the poor helpless cat that he is inevitably chasing, you know? So could be the person that they wish they were, could be the person that they think they are. And we'll discover maybe in the course of your story that they're not. You know, if your character starts the story thinking he's a real brave, courageous, tough guy, And then things hit the fan and he ends up hiding under a desk and he has suddenly realizes he is not at all who he thought he was, right? Or it could be the person that they used to be, you know, before the accident, before the divorce, before the mistake that cost them their job, right? So sometimes that you're writing that sort of story where there is a giant difference between the character as they are now and the character as they were then. And what I really love about this idea is that you can fill that gap between the character's real self and this other self. That gap can be as big or small as you want, and you can fill it with whatever emotion you're trying to create. It could be really sad and poignant, like again, the person that they used to be before the accident. It could be very sad and poignant, or it could be hilarious. Again, Pepe Le Pew or the Nutty Professor, right? That's wacky stuff. So we can put any emotion in there. But the reason I really like to linger on this idea is because that gap between the real self on the inside and the self that we are trying to project to the world, that gap is one that we as story writers are better equipped to show than any other storytelling medium out there. That internal distance between the inside self and the outside self, that gap, we can show the terrain better than movies, better than comics, better than games. We are masters of the gap. And I think it's really important to use that to our advantage. You are going to let us inside your person, right? We are going to get to walk in their skin and be them. And we are going to see just how big the difference is between their interior thoughts and feelings and who they are trying to be or become in the outside world. So that for all of us, I think, is prime real estate. And I think it's really important to know, what is that gap going to be mostly about in your character's case? And it's okay if it's not a huge one. James Bond doesn't have a huge gap between his outside self and his inside self. That's okay. But know what that gap is and how it's going to change in the course of your story. Don't be afraid to dial up those differences. Again, I think that contrast is the biggest idea underneath conflict, bigger than conflict, because it's not always about difficulty. Sometimes it's just about difference. And the more you can use that in your story, the more opportunities you have to rivet the reader to the page. So that was my contrast sermon, and it's a big one to me. It's why I put it first out of all of these 10. So I want to pause here for a quick second and invite you to put any questions or thoughts about this in the chat box before we keep going. If you have questions about how to do this in your story or what's an appropriate way to show it in your story, anything like that, go ahead and put those in the chat box for us, because I want to make sure we cover those before we move on. Yeah. Oh, and Kathy's saying like Walter Mitty. Yeah, exactly, Kathy, exactly. You totally get what I'm saying here. Yeah. And it's just, I like the idea that not everything is about conflict, because, you know, conflict's good, conflict's important, but sometimes it's just about the relevant contrast between two people, the different ways that they solve problems. Yes. Oh, and Wendy, that's a really good point, right? The sidekick, a great foil for the protagonist because they're opposites. And sometimes the fact that they are opposites makes them even better partners or makes them even better friends, right? The fact that Watson is so different from Holmes makes them a really fantastic duo. And sometimes they will have disagreements, but very often the differences aren't about disagreement. It's about having a different skill set or having a different, having different abilities. Yeah. And like Sherry was saying, Danny DeVito and Arnold Schwarzenegger, right? Just putting those two guys next to each other together on camera, it's fun to look at and it's fun to think about. Yeah. So we can do that we can make them have a problem with each other, right? We can make conflict, but we can also make some great jokes, or we can make some great emotional resonance. We can make wonderful things happen, and only some of them involve conflict. Yeah. Very good. And yeah, like Carol is saying, here's one character who's really confident, and then here's another one who's very insecure. I got to work with an author on a young adult story recently, and it's like a boy and a girl, and they both develop like superpowers kind of. And the really big difference between them is that he loves it. He loves that he is finally special, right? But she is terrified because she doesn't want to be any more different than she already is. She already sticks out. She already looks different. The last thing she wants is to be more different. She has spent her life trying to fit in, and this whole new thing is just making her life that much harder. So it's not about them being in conflict with each other, but it is showing a fantastic difference that's going to animate a great portion of the story. Yeah. Okay. So you guys got it. Make sure, by the way, too, team, if you would like everybody to be able to see your comments, make sure that you are sending them to everyone in the meeting. If you send them just to panelists, if you send them just to panelists or just to me, then I will see them. No one else will. But that's okay too. So there you go. Yeah. All right. So that was big thought number one, dialing up the contrast. Big thought number two, we are also going to spend an extra minute on, because this is another one that I notice people have lots of trouble with, especially if you're just freshly working on a first draft or just finishing a first draft. So we're going to hang here for a minute. And here's the big idea. Trey Parker and Matt Stone, the guys who created South Park, have a really successful deal going with that show. It's a very rude show, but it's been on the air for like, I don't know, 17 years or something like that. Very successful, long-running show. And they have to produce it very quickly because it's commenting kind of on current events. So they have a very, very fast turnaround to make this show. And so they've had to streamline their story writing process and storyboarding process quite a lot in order to consistently produce something that people will watch, right, very quickly. And so they talked about it at one time. There was like a documentary where they're talking about their process. And they said, well, what we do is we'll get our story events together on the storyboard, right? First this thing, then that thing, then the other thing. And we look at the connection between those events. And we notice that if we have it so that thing A happens and then thing B happens, that's really weak. That's not going to work, right? That's just a random sequence of events. It's not really a story. So what we're really trying to do is go back and change it. So instead of just thing A happens and then thing B happens, what we'll do is thing A happens and so thing B happens, or thing A happens but then thing B happens. We're trying to turn and then into a but or a so. We're trying to create a strong and continuous chain of cause and effect. And y'all, I just can't overstate how vital this is and how many writers I see who are writing excellent individual scenes that don't quite connect together, that don't have that strong and continuous chain of cause and effect. So what I would love to do with you, indulge me here for a moment. I want us to practice this together on a story that I have permission to use. My good buddy Bud has a story, a novel called The Cure, which is young adult science fiction. I worked on with him on it in an earlier draft, and so we went through it together. What I'd like to give you is the first few events in the story, and then I'm going to ask you how we might be able to rearrange them to create a stronger sequence of cause and effect. So put on your editor's hats here with me for a second. Here's what he started with. Right? He starts out with Anders, who is a lonely boy who's got a lung disease. It's kind of like asthma. This is a science fiction story, so it's a different, it's Bevelin syndrome, but okay, basically space asthma, right? So he's this lonely kid with asthma, and he's not very athletic. And one day he has a really bad asthma attack, and it gets him so bad that he's actually sent home from school for a few days. And when he's at home with nothing to do, he accidentally downloads this intelligent computer program, this hologram. Her name is Tamajitsu, and she's amazing. And what I want you to think about with Tamajitsu and Anders is kind of like Pete's Dragon or Lilo and Stitch, you know, where the kid, the lonely kid, or E.T., right, where the lonely kid meets this special magical friend that kind of turns their lives upside down. It's kind of like in that vibe. Right. So he accidentally downloads this computer program called Tamajitsu. She's amazing. And she's so amazing that she starts secretly helping Anders make money by fixing up computers in his spare time. While he's out from school, a new history teacher starts teaching, and he's not a good guy. This teacher's really bad, and he starts teaching the students really dangerous political propaganda. He's lying to them about the war that's going on right now and what's going on with it. You know, he's not a good guy. And Anders really doesn't like this new teacher. But his best friend Connolly is super under the spell of this teacher. He starts believing everything the teacher's saying. He just buys it, hook, line, and sinker. And so you can see that what we have on this screen here is there's a lot to be interested in, right? But there's not a lot of, there's a lot of causes, but there's not very many effects. There's not very many, you notice how the words in red on the left side of the screen, right? It's just and then, you know. So we don't necessarily have a very strong cause and effect sequence. So the big question that I want to ask you, and there's more than one right answer, so put them in the chat box for me, is how could we rearrange some of these events to create a stronger sequence of cause and effect? Or to put it on a finer point, is there one of these events that you would really like to use to start the story off? Give me your thoughts on this. One of the things I really love about doing this example is people come up with different things. And, you know, one of the nice things about writing is we are humanities. We are not math. There is more than one right answer here. But yeah, what could we do to rearrange this so that we have a better sequence of cause and effect, and that we don't need quite so many random just so happens types of things? Probably going to help me see your answers if I actually pull up the chat box. I will go ahead and do that now. Oh, I love it. Oh, Carol, thank you so much for eating your Wheaties. And Kathy, you ate the same Wheaties. And Wendy, everybody's eating the same Wheaties. Yes, it's brilliant, y'all. And I love that I'm amazed that so many writers agree about this. Start with the teacher. Let me tell you, okay, I don't know all of the ways in which this is brilliant, but you're brilliant. And I know you're used to hearing that, I'm sure. But one of the reasons I think that it is such a smart idea to start with the teacher is that this is an ordinary and relatable problem. We have not all had a magical friend named Tamajitsu. We haven't all had space asthma, but we have all had a bad teacher or an unfair boss or a very strict parent or some other. We have all kind of, you know, sweltered under the yoke of injustice at some point in our lives, right? And so, and I think it's really not an accident, right? That in a lot of stories, the first problem is an ordinary and relatable one. Even if we're going into fantastic events and space wars and serial killers and all of that stuff, you know, Harry Potter's first problem is that his family treat him terribly, right? Luke Skywalker's first problem is that he has to go do boring farm chores instead of cruising the strip with his buddies. And, you know, and Bilbo Baggins' first problem is that these random guys are showing up for dinner and he just wants to stay home and read books and eat tea cakes, right? So I think it's a really good idea, when possible, to try to start with this ordinary, relatable problem that the reader can empathize with, that can help us bond to this character who is very shortly going to be having exceptional problems involving space wars and serial killers, things we can't relate to. But to do this first and help us attach to that character, I think is really smart. And I love that you guys are picking up on that. In fact, going on Helen's comment just here, right? The history teacher is the reason maybe that he gets sent home, right? So y'all, it could just happen, just so happen that he happens to have a bad asthma attack, but team, what if Anders doesn't like the new teacher and so he gets into a heated argument with that teacher, which causes that bad asthma attack, right? Now, we created the same circumstance that we needed. We needed him to be home for a few days. But now we've done it in a way that reveals character. We've done it in a way that says, all right, now what sort of kid is this, our protagonist? Is he the kid who just stews quietly at the back of the class and complains to his mom when he gets home from school? No. Is this the kid who, you know, takes it up with the principal after the fact or has a word with the teacher after class in the way that you're supposed to do? No. This is the kid who's so mad he's going to stand up in the middle of class and say, you're wrong and I know you're a liar. And he's going to get into such a big argument with the teacher that he actually makes himself sick and gets sent home. Or like Helen was saying, the teacher says, get out of my classroom, go home, right? I'm writing you up a suspension. That's our kid. That's our protagonist. That is what sort of person we are about to go on an adventure with. Yeah, so we can have the same events, but now they do more for us. They show us what sort of person we are going to be with. Yeah. So then think about this, right? So now we've sent Anders home from school sick, but now he's really mad and he's been sent home from school, right? So now he's got a reason to get on the internet and go to some corners of the internet that he doesn't normally go to, because now he's really angry and he's gonna be looking for dirt on this teacher. Where did this teacher come from? What are his credentials? What's his real agenda? That's why he finds Tamajitsu, because he's going onto the dark web looking for information. He's going to places he shouldn't be going, because now he's got a, you know, he's got a mission. That's why he finds Tamajitsu. So he accidentally downloads this amazing computer program called Tamajitsu. She is wonderful. However, I did sweet talk Bud into moving off of the, she secretly helps Anders make money by fixing computers. I'm still up for doing that, but we kind of arranged to do that later in the story. So for those who are feeling really like sharp and energized here, why might we want to leave that part for later? Why might it be kind of risky to include the, oh, and she's also going to help him make a whole bunch of money right here in the very early stages of the story? Yeah. Yeah. Like, so exactly. Oh, you guys are so on it. Okay. Yes, exactly. We are solving problems that we didn't even have yet. Anders has had two problems so far in the story. One is that he is sickly. The other is that this teacher is terrible, right? Neither of those involve needing money. So we really, it's really not often a good idea to hand your character a winning lottery ticket right at the beginning of the story, unless, you know, the story is going to be about how actually secretly terrible it is to win a whole bunch of money, right? We don't want to put too much, but fortunately, into the first chapters. Usually we really want to pile on the mystery, like Wendy was saying, we don't know whether Tamajitsu is good or bad yet, right? Usually we want to pile on the mystery. We also want to pile on the tension, right? We don't want too much fortunately and not enough, oh shoot, right? So let's save that till later in the story. Let's leave that out for now. We'll get rid of that. We don't need that subplot about making money just yet. What we're trying to focus on, right? He's got this amazing, super new, intelligent computer friend. It's very exciting. And normally that's the kind of thing you would totally share with your best friend. Unfortunately, because Anders isn't there to challenge the teacher, because he's sick or suspended or whatever you want to say, Connolly doesn't have any opposing voice in his ear. Connolly has nothing left to listen to but the teacher, and he starts buying everything the teacher is saying. And that means that when Anders finally gets back to school, all excited to share this new thing with his friend, he's like, God, you know, he's going to be busting to tell Connolly about his amazing new friend Tamajitsu, and suddenly realizes Connolly's not quite Connolly anymore. Connolly is falling under the teacher's spell. I don't think it's safe to tell Connolly about my new friend Tamajitsu. I might have to keep her a secret, right? And there, in just the same amount of plot points, we have achieved an irreversible moment. A decision that is going to have enormous consequences later in the story. And I know you guys are professional fictionists, so I know you know this, right? If a character lies at the beginning of a story, if poor Aladdin starts out by telling Princess Jasmine that he is actually the fabulous Prince Ali, you know that's going to come apart later in the story. You know that there's going to be a consequence to it. And now you have a reason to stay glued to your seat to wait for that moment when it inevitably falls apart. Yeah. So to my editor brain, what this looks like from above, you know, think about like dominoes, you know, we're pushing down one domino after the other. Now, if we do this, if you look at the domino stacks from above, at the moment Anders decides to keep Tamajitsu a secret, the story splits in two, right? Now we have the school storyline with the teacher and the propaganda and Connolly and whatever's going on with that. But we also have the at-home storyline with Tamajitsu and this amazing person and, you know, not person, computer program. What can she do? Yeah. And we know, we are promised that at some point, those storylines are going to collide again. They may run separately for a while, but they will eventually converge. And they will probably do that in a way that is really explosive and interesting, right? Maybe Anders intends to tell Connolly, but then Connolly finds out somehow when Anders doesn't have a chance to do it yet, and then he's going to be really hurt. He's going to be betrayed. He might turn Anders into the teacher or turn Tamajitsu into the teacher. Or automatically, your reader mind is spinning with the possibilities because you can see how this could go wrong. Yeah. Yeah. And what I really appreciate you guys thinking about this example with me because as you see here, we have made significant improvements to the sequence, but we're keeping almost all of what the author originally included. There was like the money-making plot point we might push back or delete, but dramatic improvements don't necessarily mean throw away everything you have. Sometimes and often it's just really about reordering them to create that strong and ongoing sequence of cause and effect. And that's what I really encourage you to think about, especially when you get to revision mode, is where are my and then moments? How do I change them so that they are a but or a so? Yeah. And again, y'all, this one is a big one. So we spent a few extra minutes on it, but I want to pause here before we keep going. Do you have any questions about that art of strengthening that chain of cause and effect about, yeah, how do we do that at various stages in the story, or how do you know when? If there's anything like that that you want to think about, go ahead and put that in the chat box because I really want to make sure we hit that before we keep going. I'm even going to move my chat box. And I love seeing your shining, glorious faces, even though you're muted, because sometimes I'll drop something and I see like, oh, and I'm like, yeah, got one. Sherry totally bought that. I don't know about everybody else, but I know Sherry was into it. Yeah. Okay. So I'm going to take it that we're good now. I don't see anything else in chat box. So let's keep going. All right. I will consider your minds thoroughly blown. All right. So then, thing three, and we can move a little faster on something. I wanted to hit the big ones while you're still full of juice, but these ones we'll move a little faster on. Number three. It is often, especially toward the middle of the story, if you are feeling bogged down or like things are taking too long, consider taking the reasonable option off the table. So for example, I don't know if anybody saw Firefly when it was on the air. It's a wonderful show. Noreen knows what I'm talking about. So there was an unfilmed episode, it was scripted but never filmed, in which the characters of the ship, and you see all of them on the screen here, it's not like Star Trek where there's 1,000 people, no, it's like 8 people or 9 people. They find a planet, they find some colonists on a moon, and the moon is freezing. These colonists are stranded, and if they aren't rescued quickly, they're going to freeze to death. We have to get them off the planet. The reasonable thing to do, of course, would be to rescue all the colonists. But the story writers, the script writers said, okay, so let's take away the reasonable option. We're gonna say that there are too many colonists to fit on our ship indefinitely. We are going to say that we could rescue all of the colonists, but that will overwhelm the ship's life support system and it will fail within 1 week. So now we have some hard choices. Oh, and by the way, there are no other ships and no other worlds within 1 week. So our choices are rescue everybody and hope that we meet a passing ship within 1 week before we all die. Number two, rescue only some of the people and try to choose which ones you're going to take. Or option three is, sorry, you know, can't do anything. So in the story, the characters argue about it. And if you've seen Firefly, you can imagine what a heated discussion that is. And finally, the Captain Mal here, Nathan Fillion, says, well, look, y'all, they're not going to freeze to death overnight. We got some time. Let's all sleep on it. And in the morning, we're going to take a vote. And whatever we decide, that's what we're going to do. And so, okay, everybody goes to bed. And in the morning, they wake up. The crew members wake up. The ship is already miles away in deep space, and they have rescued no one. The captain has taken the ship away from the colony and left all of the colonists to die so that he would spare the crew the agony of that decision. He has taken everything upon his own conscience and said, and you know, he's basically lied to his own crew. He said that there was going to be a vote, no vote. He took the ship away while the colonists are asleep. The crew are devastated, some of them, but they are innocent. They, you know, he has taken everything upon himself too, so that they would not have to pass judgment over these people's lives. And you can see, you know, if you're thinking about this with me, you're like, wow, that's dark, but that really says a lot about him, right? And so, and that the point I would like to make here is that when the reasonable option is gone, whatever happens next will say a lot about the character. It will speak volumes about the person making the choice, because the good and easy choice is nowhere. So which bad choice are you going to go for, right? Your character, you know, she's going to the airport to visit, to get on the plane, to go see her mother. Her mother is ill. She really needs to get, not miss the flight, but her cat is missing. We can't find the cat anywhere. What do you do? Do you miss your flight to look for Kitty? Do you trust that Kitty will turn up somewhere in order to make the flight, right? Your character is the kind of stand-up heroic dude who would absolutely help that poor woman who's broken down on the side of the road with her two little kids and the flat tire. But this is the first job interview he's had in months, and he's about to be late. What's he gonna do? Is he gonna blow off the job interview in order to help these people? Because man, that they're right on the side of the freeway. That's some fast moving traffic. Those are some little tiny kids. I don't know. But at the same time, he's got obligations to his family, you know? And I would even suggest, the script writers for Firefly didn't do this, but I would suggest too, that if you want to do something like this, it will hurt more if the reasonable option is on the table at the beginning and then something happens to take it away. You know, if our ship had rolled up onto the colony world, seen the people that needed rescuing, said, great, we can totally take you. And then there is a catastrophic engine failure that takes out part of the life support system and now we can't take everyone, right? We thought we could do it. We thought we could help everybody. It seemed like it would be a total slam dunk. And then something terrible happened. Mistakes were made. An accident happened. Now the ship is at half life support and we can't take anybody. I mean, we can't take everybody anymore. We can only take half the people, right? Or whatever. If the reasonable option is there at first and then something happens that ruins it, it's going to hurt that much more. And it's going to say, again, whatever happens next is going to be a powerful testament to the character. Whatever they decide will say who they really are when push comes to shove. Yeah. So you could do the thing where you take away the reasonable option, right? The lesser of two evils kind of choice. Corollary to that, you could also do a thing where you add a conflicting gain, right? Where you can have one good thing or the other good thing, but you cannot have both. So for example, you know, Ariel in The Little Mermaid. She loves her sister, she loves her father, she loves her life mostly, right? But if she wants to become human, she will have to leave that behind and not see her father and sisters anymore. She will be giving up her whole life, you know, in order to become human and potentially be with this hunky dude that she saw one time, maybe. And every parent knows, you know, when you watch Little Mermaid, like, you're an idiot. Stop. You don't know that guy. Don't be human for him. Don't throw it all away. You saw him for like 4 seconds. You don't know who he is. Anyway, so this would be the mutually exclusive goods. So you can think about the Little Mermaid. You could think about King Edward VIII, who was forced to abdicate because he wanted to marry the American divorcee, Wallis Simpson, back in 1937, right? He could be king, or he could be with the love of his life, but he could not do both. And again, that choice, no matter which way the character goes, it's going to speak volumes about them. So we got the lesser of two evils option. This is the mutually exclusive goods choice, right? This is the kind of the corollary to that. So those are easy ways that you can put a character in a really tough spot and show, not just say, who they really are. You can also add a different kind of conflict when you feel your story is lagging. And I'll show you what I mean by that, right? So if you've ever felt like, you know, I'm trying to do all the right things for my genre, but I feel like maybe I'm doing it too much, or I'm holding the same note for too long, or I'm just turning up the volume on the same note rather than actually changing the music. Here's what you can do. Dave Corbett wrote a really good book called The Art of Character, and he talks about three essential kinds of conflict. He says you've got internal conflict, right? The difficulty within the self. You've got interpersonal conflict, which is the difficulty between two or more people, right? And then you've got the external conflict, the difficulty between a person and some aspect of their world. They've lost their job, or there's an asteroid heading toward Earth, or they're, the evil empire is about to just conquer everything or whatever. The Titanic is about to sink. That's a big deal. And what he said, this probably has echoes of your 10th grade English class, right? About the, you know, man versus nature and man versus man and whatever. Well, what Dave Corbett said that I thought was really interesting that I had not heard before was, he says, you know, the thing is, internal and interpersonal conflict generate sympathy from the reader. We saw this with Anders, right? If we put the whole conflict with the teacher first, we relate to that. We feel for Anders, like, oh, that's so unfair. I feel for you, buddy. I've had those issues myself. But Dave Corbett says, external conflict generates admiration from the reader. When you think about a James Bond movie, which is all external conflict, mostly external conflict, it's all about car chases and action sequences and whatever, we're not supposed to feel bad for James Bond. We're not supposed to feel sympathy for him. We're not supposed to relate to him. We're supposed to be sitting there thinking, whoa, you totally just flipped that Bugatti over the canals of Venice while you used your Invisinator machine to hide, escape the bat. You know, that's so cool and rad. I totally want to be you, James Bond. That's so neat. It is fun to vicariously live through you. That's neat, right? When Bruce Willis saves the Earth from the asteroid, we're not supposed to feel for him, really. We're supposed to be, like, amazed. And so what I notice is that most genres rely heavily on one of these kinds of conflict, right? If we're going to write a romance, that is mostly going to be internal and interpersonal conflict. But if all we do is internal and interpersonal conflict, that can get to feeling like you're hitting the same note too much, too long, for too often, right? And that's where it's good to add a different kind of conflict. That's why we have the Bond girl in a James Bond movie. If all we did was external conflict, if all we did was action sequences and car chases and high stakes poker games and whatever, that would be exhausting. So usually at some point in the movie, there's going to be a femme fatale, and there's going to be the romance and the intrigue and the, wow, she's so beautiful, but can I trust her? She may or may not end up dead. But that adds a different note, right? And so I think it's, and that's why, similarly in romance, right? Most of it's going to be internal interpersonal conflict, but there's very often an external subplot about the bank is about to get the farm, or, somebody's got cancer, or, he just lost his job, or he got hurt at the rodeo or something that gives us that kind of is the yang to our yin, that gives us some balance. So I think it's a really good idea, especially if you're writing mystery, a lot of it is external conflict. Who did the thing? Can we track them down? Can we put together the clues in time, right? So sometimes it can be good if you feel like you've done all you can do on that front and you need something different, then yeah, where's the internal conflict coming from? Where's the interpersonal conflict in your story? Is it appropriate to put a little dash of that in? I think it's really important to know what sort of conflict is your bread and butter, but also don't neglect the salt and the jam, because that can sometimes give you a nice break from your main action. And that can also, give the reader a respite so that we're ready for the next big thing of your main plot. Are you buying this? Yeah. Okay. Good deal. Okay. Okay. Very good. All right. So, number five, and this is just a quickie, whatever your character is the absolute worst at, what if they had to do it, right? In if you like fantasy, if you play Dungeons and Dragons, we say force the wizard to throw a punch. That is the last thing the wizard wants to do. He's no good at it. He's terrible at it, right? But if you're not into fantasy, you can think about Arnold Schwarzenegger in Kindergarten Cop. You can think about Sandra Bullock in Miss Congeniality. You can think about these characters who are forced into situations that are completely outside their expertise. And some stories, like Miss Congeniality and Kindergarten Cop, are entirely about that. Other stories are not really about that, but maybe, in the heist movie, there's this big plan where the computer hacker is going to hack into the bank's security systems, and then the sweet talker is going to distract the guard out front while the demolitions experts bust through the back wall. They've all got this plan, and then it all goes to merry hell, and somehow the computer hacker ends up trying to sweet talk his way in the front door while the demolitions expert is trying to figure out what buttons on the computer he's supposed to push, and the sweet talker is pounding ineffectually at the back door of the bank. Everybody's doing the wrong job. Everybody's doing the thing they are least qualified for. This can be hilarious and a nice change of pace. If I want to make James Bond really sweat, if I want to make him fear for his life, I'm not going to kidnap him and put him at gunpoint. He does that every Tuesday. I'm going to make him babysit, and I will see him sweat as we have never seen him sweat before. So maybe your whole story doesn't need to be about this, this concept, but maybe there can be a moment where your person, your hard-boiled PI, whoever he is, he's forced to entertain at a children's birthday party, and he is about to come apart at the seams. That can be such a nice change, especially if you've been doing grim, dark, track down the serial killer stuff. This can be a wonderful break, right? And again, shows character, gives a plot a little bit of a respite, puts us on very different footing for a little minute, can be marvelous, right? Like a peach sorbet in between courses. Yeah, yeah. All right, so on the back half, I've got... let's see here. I've got some, these ones won't take too long. We ought to be well done and dusted by 3:15, 3:30. But I want to pause just briefly. If you have anything else you want to talk about on numbers 1 through 5, go ahead and put like an exclamation in the chat box so that I know you're about to type a bigger comment so I don't steamroll you. If you have anything else we need to talk about with these hot tips before I turn the page, put a little exclamation in there so I can see that you want us to hold on so you can ask a question. I don't see those at the moment, so I'm going to go with Kathy's plus signs that we are A plus, good to go. Okay, we will turn the page. And y'all, if you think of something later, I got an email. I might even give it to you. It'll be all right. Okay, so turning the page. Here we go. This one, you may want to unhinge your jaw a little bit. This is a big bite. Using what is called the four stages of competence. This is a psychological thing that I did not know very much about until recently. Someone told me about it, which was a huge mistake because now I want to make my entire life be about this. This is a psychological term that I do think has a lot of applications to fiction. Here's what it is, right? The four stages of competence go like this. Stage one is unconscious incompetence. This is when you suck so bad you don't even know you suck. This is what a three-year-old thinks driving is. A three-year-old doesn't even know that they can't drive. They think driving is just turning the wheel back and forth, right? This is the Dunning-Kruger area. These are the people you work with. These are the people who can't figure out reply all. You know what I'm talking about. You've seen them. They are among us, okay? You're so bad at the thing, you don't even realize you are bad at it. Stage two is conscious incompetence. And that's where you suck and you know you suck. And that's more like an 8 or a 10-year-old. They know they can't drive. They've seen mom and dad drive. They know there are pedals and levers involved. They know it's a project, right? So you know about the thing in this stage, you just can't do it yet. And sometimes that's really frustrating. So remember, team, if you leave this presentation thinking you are terrible at writing, congratulations, you just graduated to stage two. All right, then stage three is conscious competence. That's where this is your 15-year-old with their learner's permit. This is where you can do the thing if you really, really buckle down and focus and think super hard. This is your 15-year-old with the learner's permit who can back out of the garage without dinging the mirrors if they are totally laser focused on the task, right? And then stage four, right? If we work really hard, is unconscious competence. And that's where you are just naturally good at doing the thing. You don't really have to focus or concentrate or try. You can just do it. This is where most adult drivers are. Not Dallas drivers, but a lot of adult drivers, right? We don't have to think about how to back out of the driveway. We just do it because we've done it so often. We can do it. What I really like about these four stages of competence, there's several things. One is that this maps pretty nicely to the hero's journey, if that is a system that you are using. I'm not a person who lives and dies according to the hero's journey, those four stages kind of fit sort of nicely with those quadrants, the Act 1, the Act 2A, Act 2B, and Act 3. And usually what is dividing those quarters is an event of some kind that causes a character to reevaluate themselves. There's like, you know, if your character starts with unconscious incompetence, she is convinced that all men are terrible, that there's no such thing as a good man, that she's never going to find anybody she wants to be with. Every date she's ever had has been a disaster. What is up with men? Seriously, right? Then maybe around this quadrant right here, about that quarter mark, something happens and she realizes, oh, it's not them. It's me. I am the common factor in all of these terrible dates. You know, there's something I'm doing that there's a reason that I can't find happiness, and it's not just them, it's me, right? She has moved. Something has happened that causes her to move from that stage one, unconscious incompetence, to stage two, which is realizing she's got a problem. The other thing that I really like about these four stages of competence is that, and this is relevant for you guys as mystery writers, right? A lot of times in your genre, mystery, crime, thriller, all of those things, for characters like John Wayne or Columbo or that sort of James Bond, that sort of person, it's not really about mastering a skill because they start the story already good at investigating or problem solving, whatever. It's about stages, understanding of a problem, right? So if I were going to map this four stages of competence to a thriller, I might say, okay, in stage one, some homeless people have been turning up dead, but no one really thinks anything about it yet. We think that they just overdosed. They're homeless. We don't really miss them. It just happens, right? We don't realize we have a problem. And then in stage two, we realize somebody's murdering people. There is a person out there who is behind this. We don't know who it is. Their bodies are stacking up. The mayor's office is on the phone, breathing down our necks. The media is out front. We are overwhelmed by how much we don't know. Things are really scary. And all we know is that we don't have any good leads yet. And this is terrible, right? And then in stage three of the story, we're putting together the clues and we're tracking down leads and we're interviewing people and we are getting on toward, we're creating a profile of our killer, right? And in stage four, we know who it is. We know it's Buffalo Bill. He's been stealing these girls. We know who he is and why he does what he does. We know how he operates. We can think like him. We've talked to Hannibal. We know what's going on. And now all we got to do is go out there and get him before he has, before it's too late for the girl in the pit, right? Yeah. So you could use these four stages. So these four stages of competence could go with a character mastering an internal skill, like again, in a romance or, some learning to be a better person, anything that involves overcoming a personal flaw. But they can also go pretty well, I think, in some externally focused stories, like solving a series of crimes. The thing I would like to emphasize is going back to our driver's metaphor for a moment. Well, the 3-year-old, the 10-year-old, the 15-year-old, the adult driver. When you think about this, the stage at which a person is likely to kill themselves or other people behind the wheel, think about the age at which drivers are most often involved in fatalities. I'm not talking about dinging the mailbox. I'm talking about wrapping the car around the tree, right? We worry a lot and we see a lot of that happening at 17 years old, 18 years old, 22 years old. These people who think they've been driving for a few years, they think they've mastered it. They have not quite mastered it. And they don't learn that until a terrible accident has happened. So in the hero's journey, the worst possible thing happens at the 50% mark, the abyss right here, the death and rebirth, whatever. For my money, it doesn't need to be. Again, I don't live and die by the hero's journey. But I think that if you are going to have a moment where you wreck the car, where your character wrecks the car, so to speak, anywhere in that third quadrant, that conscious competence, anywhere in there is prime territory for a character to think they've graduated to stage four, and really they haven't. They think, this is usually that third quadrant, that's where the romantic couple have their traumatic breakup. That's where we arrest the wrong suspect, leaving the real killer free to murder the detective's wife, right? This is where we make the most catastrophic error of the whole story. And I don't think every story needs a wrap a car around the tree moment, but if you're going to have one anywhere in that 50 to 75 mark, that's the danger zone, I think, when your character has been successful enough for long enough that they think they've got it down cold, and they don't. And we learn that in the most painful possible way. I think that can be really powerful when it's well executed. The other thing, the last thing I really want to emphasize about these four stages of competence, they do also apply to you, the writer, but you do not have a single dial that's called your skill at writing and, oh, you're a 2 or you're a 3 or you're a 1. No, there's a million different dials out there, y'all. One of them is called dialogue. There's another one called pacing. There's one called, character development. There's another one, blurb writing. There's one that's, outlining. There's a million freaking dials. And yours are probably all over the place. You might be a natural 4 at dialogue. You're just good at it. You're just good at writing dialogue. You always have been. But the only thing you know about pacing is that you're terrible at it, and you're a 2 at pacing and you know it. And maybe you're a 1 at micro tension because you don't even know what the Dickens micro tension is. And you're looking at me like, oh God, what is it? What, Go look up micro tension. It's like micro machines, tension, like creating tension in your story. Donald Moss has a lot of good stuff about it. Kathy Gresher says, boo, blurb writing. Don't worry, Kathy. We can help with that. But y'all, you got a million dials. They're all in different places. And the effort that you put into belonging to Sisters in Crime, to being part of this group, to helping each other out, that is what moves the needles. And anytime you feel bad about something, you're like, oh, I'm so bad at pacing. Oh, I'm so terrible at scene startings and endings. Well, if you know enough to know that you don't have it mastered yet, you are already at stage 2 out of 4. And a lot of people never move beyond 1. They don't even realize that they don't have it mastered yet. You do. So you're already at least 25% of the way there. And all you need to do to get the rest of the way is not quit. Right, to work on mastering the thing, 1 at a time. Yeah. And I have found personally in my experience as a writer that the things I struggled the most with ended up being the things that people loved the most about my work. It was never the things I was automatically good at. They're like, oh yeah, she writes good dialogue. But the things I sweated bullets over were the things that still light up my Amazon comments to this day. You think about poor Demosthenes, that ancient Greek guy who stuttered so badly and he couldn't get past his stutter, and he put pebbles in his mouth and he walked around with pebbles in his mouth all day to force himself to learn to speak around a mouthful of rocks, and ended up being one of the best orators that ancient Greece ever knew, right? Because he was willing to handicap himself to overcome that difficulty. And if you are willing to do that, you can absolutely get to those stage 4s. Not overnight, but it can happen. Are you feeling pumped? Can you do it? Yeah. All right. Get a huge amen. Socially distanced amen. All right. So, yes. Okay. So that was a big one. I got a couple of little ones. These are light and easy and fun. So thank you for giving me your best brain for tip 6. All right. So just a couple of quickies here then. Number 7, the thing that your character is dreading, that awful thing that they would hate most in the world, what would cause them to deliberately bring it on themselves? Your character who is terrified of losing her dream job, what would cause her to quit? Say, I'm done, and walk out. Your guy who is just can't imagine, he's terrified of being alone. What would cause him to do the breaking up with her? What would cause him to walk away from the relationship? You know, your person who is just horrified at the thought that she might lose custody of her kids. What would cause her to willingly give it up? What sort of danger would she have to be in to voluntarily send her children away, right? Because the answer to that, whatever the answer is, that speaks to a deeper level of the plot, right? It says, okay, how do I make things bad enough that our person not just has the bad thing happen to them, but brings it upon themselves? Because somehow that is the better option. That is the deep end of the pool, team. And I encourage you, even if it's not something that you're going to need in this story that you're working on, keep that in your memory banks for the future. Because whatever you set us up to worry about in the early stages of the story probably will come true in the later stages, but maybe it can be a jump before you're pushed moment. And again, that anybody can fall off a cliff, but a certain kind of character will jump off the cliff first. That's deep. Yeah. Okay. So that's thing 7. Thing 8, I will give you $1, a solid American dollar, if you can include some sort of well-intentioned catastrophe in your story. My favorite meme is this one here with the shark. Like, oh no, there's a human trapped in this cage. Don't worry, buddy. I'll get you out with my teeth. Right? So our well-intentioned shark is going to be biting and snapping at this cage. And with the best of intentions, this will not be perceived well by the diver who's in the shark cage, right? And a more direct way of thinking about this, I don't know if anybody has seen Mrs. Doubtfire with Robin Williams, but it starts with Robin Williams' character, who's throwing the best birthday party ever for his kid. And he's got a clown, and he's got a pony, and there's kids running around everywhere, and there's a bouncy house in the backyard, just the biggest deal ever. And he's having a ball, of course. And then his wife comes home, and all, you know, she doesn't know anything about this. She's brought a nice little Costco cake, you know, for the kid's birthday, to have a nice, reasonable birthday. And she comes home, and there's like pony poop in the living room, and the clown is smoking in the kitchen, and there's chaos and kids and mess running everywhere. And she looks at her husband, Robin Williams' character, and she says, "I want a divorce." And you're just like, wow, what a horror. I mean, here was a guy who was trying to just throw his kid the best party ever. And he has somehow inadvertently put the straw that broke the camel's back. He has wrecked his own marriage. And I'm sure, obviously, you know, we're given to think there were a lot of things that happened before that. But yeah, that, you know, y'all, we have all done that thing where we did something with the best of intentions because we were sure that it would be the best surprise or the most thoughtful thing. And your character, you know, she's young and in love, and her boyfriend is the star player on the football team, and she just is so excited that they're dating, and so she makes him a special cake for his birthday. She doesn't know that he's deathly allergic to gluten or eggs or whatever, and he's in the hospital because of this cake, and he misses the big game, right? And she is now responsible for jeopardizing his whole football career. What a terrible thing, right? That kind of explosive kick in the face garners instant wincing sympathy from the reader. We've all been there. It hurts so much even to contemplate. And again, you as writers, you know, the world can see the results, but you as the writer can show us the character's intention that maybe no one else in the whole world got to see. And then I think it's a great idea to take advantage of that. Like, no one else in the world knew what this person was thinking when they did this apparently stupid thing, but you can show us how they meant for the best, even though the worst thing happened because of it. Yeah. And it hurts to read in the best possible way. So that's thing 8. Thing 9, just a couple of quickies here. You can, if you have a problem with navel gazing, if you have a problem with characters sitting and ruminating for too long about what they should do, you know, like they're stewing on the big problem and they stew for pages at a time, right? If you have a problem with letting them stew too long or ponder too long, try using so to turn emotion into action, right? Say, okay, so this thing happens and my guy is upset about that. How upset? Well, so upset that he decides he's going to solve the problem his own dang self. So he picks up his shotgun and, you know, felony results, whatever. She is really eager to jump in and do this project. How eager? Well, so eager that she doesn't really look at all the steps involved before she gets into it and quickly realizes that she's in over her head. So can be a great way to take a big emotion and turn it into a big action that shows up well on the page, right? So we don't stew too long in those deep dramatic juices. You can also use so to turn virtues into faults. You can have a character and you can say, oh, she's really generous. How generous? Well, so generous that she takes on too much, and that she makes too many promises to too many people. So she gets overwhelmed. So she gets, she gets overscheduled. She starts dropping balls. She starts breaking the promises that she made. People start hating her when she had the best of intentions, right? There it is, the Tex Thompson story. You can easily have a person who goes too far in that good direction. And conversely, you know, since we're talking about contrast, right, the opposites of the protagonist and their best friend, well, maybe the best friend, the protagonist is the one whose virtue turns into a fault, right, that she's too generous, she takes on too much, she gets too overwhelmed, she makes a mess, she drops the balls. Maybe the friend is the one who's got a fault that we can turn into a virtue, right? Maybe the friend is the one who is always shooting off at the mouth who is just the most rude, brusque person in the world, who is constantly getting in trouble for saying the wrong thing or being rude to people, right? And that's obviously a big fault, a big problem. But maybe that person is actually, you know, that kind of rude, tell it like it is roughness is the only honesty that our protagonist will get. Maybe that best friend whose big fault is her rudeness and bluntness is the only person that will sit the protagonist down and say, Becky, you gotta stop sleeping with the first guy who asks you to prom. This is all you know. You gotta stop being so generous. You're over here crying. You have made this mess for yourself. You need to get yourself out of it, right? So basically that so can go in either direction. And I really like the idea, especially y'all, if you're writing a crime mystery thriller series where your protagonist isn't gonna change a whole ton from one book to the next. I really like the idea that person's best qualities are the inescapable, inextricable other side of the coin from their worst qualities, right? These are not just a grab bag of random characteristics we chose. This is two sides of a coin, that their best features are their worst features and cannot be otherwise. We can't have an honest person without having some level of telling people what they don't want to hear, right? It just can't be, we can't have it. You can't make an omelet without breaking the eggs. So yeah, so you can use so if that helps you to kind of make those connections. And I'm going to give you, we're about at the 3:15, 3:20 mark. So this will be the last one, but the last big thing I want to give to you is number 10, which is, I guess that was tip number 10. All right, I'm giving you a bonus tip. I'm not even going to charge you extra, all right? You're welcome. Bonus content. All right, bonus tip, and this is the one for the prize. Y'all, I will sing your praises if you are brave enough to let the worst thing actually happen in the course of your story. And by that I mean, we'll talk about more about what worst thing means, but think about this, right? What if the end of your story is only the middle? What if the worst possible thing actually happens in the course of the story? I'm gonna put up the Lion King slide here, and the people saw that movie, you're gonna get real sad. They're like, oh no, so the part where Simba's dad died. You could put the part where Bambi's mom gets shot if you rather. But notice these moments, the worst possible moments, they are not usually the beginning of the story or the end of it. They are right in the middle. And to me, the worst possible thing you can do to a character, first of all, it's not killing them. Death is never the worst possible thing that could happen to a character, because if your character is lined up and shot by the firing squad, they get to die shaking their fist at God, still convinced of their righteous cause, right? You get to go out mad at someone, right? If you want to. To me, the worst possible thing is not the thing with the biggest body count, the one that causes the most damage. It is the thing that wrecks your character's identity, the thing that will force them to rewrite the story they've always told about themselves. So thought exercise here, right? Think about, let's say we have a character and she's a mom. Like, that is thing one in her life. She loves being a mom. She's a good wife and, you know, she has a job too, but she loves doing kid stuff. She loves teaching them. She loves taking them out and planning fun activities. She loves, you know, just being a mom feels like the best thing she's ever done. When we think about how we hurt that character the most, right? I would ask this to the live class and say, okay, so how do we hurt this character? And inevitably there would be a hand in the back and somebody would say, kill the children. I was like, oh, dark. I was actually in the Sisters in Crime chapter that said, it was the Frisco Sisters in Crime chapter that did that. I was like, and you're in the right writing group. Okay, but picture this, right? Because if the kids just die, there's somebody to be angry at usually. You know, there's the drunk driver or the manufacturer of the car or the whatever, the terrorist, whatever. There's somebody else you can be mad at, right? You still get to think that you were a good mom in most cases. But y'all, even in, and so the less dark version is, Let's say there's an ugly divorce and the husband gets custody of the kids. Again, there's somebody else to be mad at. She can be mad at him and say, you took my children from me, right? But imagine a scenario in which the judge asks the children, because they're old enough, they're of an age. He says, what would you prefer here? And the kids say, we want to go with dad. Sorry, mom, you're just too much. That's going to hurt. That is going to force her to rewrite that story that she's always told herself about what a great mom she is, right? If this guy is thinking, I'm a brilliant doctor, until he makes a mistake that gets a patient killed. If the character is an amazing football player until his ACL is torn and he can no longer play football. Well, if you can't play football anymore, then what are you good for, right? People whose identities are based around one single thing, whether it's being a mom or playing football or whatever, are brittle. They are brittle, and you can take them apart if you hazard or destroy that thing that they base themselves on. You can even do this by giving them what they think they wanted, right? If you've got a couple who says, oh, you know, we're fighting constantly, but we're fighting all the time because we're broke. If we just had a bunch of money, we'd be happy. Well, sometimes the worst thing you can do to that couple is to let them have a whole ton of money, have them win the lottery, have them inherit something. Now they're rich and miserable, and they can no longer tell themselves why that is. The old story doesn't work anymore, right? They can no longer say, oh, it's because money. No, you got money, you still got a problem. And that is a painful moment when you are having to rewrite your own narrative. It's one of the hardest things the human brain can do. So for me, I think that this is the hardest thing to write, but it is also one of the most important things to know about or to attempt, right? Because at the end of the day, all of us are living beyond something that our younger selves would have considered unsurvivable. You who are listening to me right now are living beyond the end of a relationship that you thought you couldn't do without. You are living beyond the death of a person who mattered so much to you. You are living, we are living through a literal global pandemic right now, doing it in our pants, not pants, whatever you got. I'm not going to ask, right? But we are living beyond an unsurvivable thing. And we are doing that, right? And I think it is so important to have the courage to push the characters beyond that unsurvivable event horizon. To let your person arrest the wrong suspect, and you know, for the real killer to go murder the detective's wife, to let the heroine actually marry the wrong guy and end up sleeping with him for like 6 months after before she realizes what a mistake she made, right? None of this Zorro swooping in to save them at the altar. No. To let the worst thing happen, to force your character beyond that unsurvivable event horizon, because that is what your reader is going to be grappling with at some point in their own lives. And you don't know where they're reading your book. Even if you're writing fun escapist, whatever, you don't know if you're going to have that book read by someone who's sitting in the waiting room of an oncology office or on a plane to some place they wish they'd never had to go. You know, you're writing this character, this fictional person, pushing your fictional person beyond their limits is going to be the best promise that you can make to the real human being reading your words, that they too can be go beyond the limits and still make it. And I think, you know, like, not to get too weird on you or anything, but it's easy to write the story of Job. It's a story of a person to whom, you know, the sky falls on his head and every bad thing happens and he just has to deal with it. It is harder and rarer and I think really special to find a writer who can write the story of Simon Peter, to write the story of a guy, the first of the disciples, the one who counted himself, as Christ's truest, most loyal friend. He really thought he was that person. And then, you know, bad stuff happened and things got hard. And before he knew it, he had denied all knowledge of his best friend 3 times before the cock crowed. And his best friend is dead, not just taken away in prison. Oh, we got to go bust him out in a big dramatic action sequence. Dead. He's gone. It's too late. You screwed up. You were not the person you thought you were. You did the worst of all things. And this is what happened. And somehow he gets redeemed. We get to come back from that, right? We that story doesn't end there, right? The redemption of Peter is this huge deal. He goes on to found the church. I mean, he goes on to do amazing things. But the only way you get to write that wonderful redemption is to first go to that darkest of places. And it's okay if that's not suitable for your current story. It's okay if you're not comfortable going there just yet. I really want to leave you with the idea of writing at that level, whether it's today or tomorrow or next year or whenever you are equipped to do it, because that's territory that your competition is too timid to touch. And if you can work your way up to doing that, maybe you're already doing it, you can take your work to places that very few writers are willing to go, and you can give your reader an experience that very few stories let them have. And I think that's really, really good whenever we can. So I've come up to just about the limit of our time, but that's the big idea I want to leave you with, is if you need help surviving your unsurvivable project, right, hit me up, let me know. I'm throwing a lot of things at you in this last hour and a half or so. I'm really sorry that we didn't get to do more back and forth, but I would love to talk more if you would like help, if you have questions. But for now, I guess I'm going to say that's really all I've got. You can hit me up if you would like to, if you think about other things, you want to talk more. You can always find me at tex@thetexfiles.com. It's like the X-Files, but it's the Tex Files. I really like what you're doing. I like that you belong to Sisters in Crime, that you come to these meetings, even during the most current of circumstances. I'd love to turn it back over to Noreen and Maureen, our gracious hostesses, so they can tell us what we need to know for next time.
Thank you, Tex. I really appreciate everything you did today. This has been a wonderful presentation. It was absolutely fabulous. I loved it. Absolutely loved it. We look forward to having you back again sometime after the world allows people to meet in person. Mm-hmm. We are all looking forward to that. And everybody, we look forward to having you all back next month for our next meeting with Bill Woodburn. If you have any questions for Tex, email her. If you're interested in being on the board, email me. Thank you so much, everyone, and thank you, Maureen, for hosting us.
Thank you so much. Have a good day.
Thanks, team. We'll see you next time.
Yeah, great. Bye.